Oh, there's a Maariko. Hello, Maariko.
When you have a moment,
Pathfinder, we should talk.
This is a tremendous honor.
Oh, thank you.
I must express my admiration for all you've done. Crossing the void between galaxies.
Oh, shucks.
Navigating the Scourge to find Aya. Incredible.
The odds were against us, that's for sure.
Yet here we are. Strangers from different galaxies conversing in friendship. Extraordinary.
Mm-hmm.
I am Maariko Daresh, Chief Phoneron.
Wondering about this, but yeah, it's an honor.
It's a privilege to meet you. Tell me about yourself.
I'm something of a pathfinder myself.
Oh?
I am a celestial observer, charting the movements of stars, planets, and the Scourge.
An astronomer. You know the safe routes out there?
We deploy satellites that alert us to new hazards and opportunities. But we've lost contact with several key observers. They've simply stopped. I sent a vessel to scan their last known locations, but nothing's been found. Your Tempest is highly advanced. I hoped you could aid our search.
Of course.
Even Pathfinders need a good map. I'll look into it.
I knew you'd understand. I'll provide search nav points. And when I can finally reconcile our charts with fresh satellite data, I'll gladly share all we have.
Oh, thanks.
Hello, Pathfinder. How can I help?
So you've been tracking the Scourge, huh?
How good are your satellites at watching the Scourge?
They've served us well for many decades. My grandmother led the program that designed them, and my mother tended them before me.
Does the Scourge change shape and direction often?
On an astronomical scale, it's like a fast-moving river. Hmm. But travel routes generally remain stable for years at a time.
Could your colonies wind up cut off from each other?
Worse than that. If the Scourge engulfs a world, everything on it dies.
Hmm. Tell me about your Angara space program.
How long have your people had space travel?
Before the Scourge, we colonized many worlds. Or so we're told.
You don't know for sure?
The Scourge erased all records. Everything became myth. Passed down as oral history.
Hmm.
We rebuilt our space program only a few hundred years ago.
From Stone Age to Space Age in a few centuries. Impressive.
Nothing will keep us from the stars. Not the Scourge, not Ket. We belong out there.
Hmm. Tell me about the other Angara colonies.
How many planets have you colonized?
When we returned to space after the Scourge, we discovered our civilization had survived on 5 worlds. People from one of those worlds found and settled Aya.
Hmm. Could there be more Angaran worlds from before the Scourge? Ones you don't know about?
That's one reason we travel the stars, in hope of finding what we've lost.
This looks like a piece of bread with like grill marks on it. Or meat, like chicken. I should go.
That's all for now.
Stars and skies protect you.
And also with you. Oh yay, more quests. Okay, it's kind of weird to cut it off here. Can't jump over this freaking thing. So I'm going to sit over here, or stand over here, and read a little codex before we sign off, because I'm going to split this into two, and as it stands, it'll be only 23-minute episodes. That'll stink. So let's see what's been added to the codex. I'm sure there's new stuff. Yep, the journey so far. Finding a home. You saved Moshai Sfefa, but angered her by refusing to destroy the Ket Exaltation Facility. Jal approved of your decision, hoping the Resistance can one day rescue the innocent Angara still trapped inside. You made sure the Ket Cardinal in charge of the Exaltation Facility did not survive meeting you. Yeah, that was cool. I thought there were two things that had it. Alright. A crew like no other. Cora Harper, something new? You and Cora have become confidants as well as colleagues. She's clearly glad to have you as a friend. That's nice. Suvi? Ooh. You and Suvi have also spent some time talking about your respective families. Suvi's parents were both academics and inspired her to begin her journey in science. You're growing closer, and it might be more than friendship. Ooh. Vetranix. She confided in you that when Sid and Vetra's father abandoned them, she had to raise Sid alone. Her life has been spent keeping her sister safe and giving her the best life possible. In their circumstances, if the initiative fails, Vetra will have failed Sid. She refuses to accept that outcome. Okay. And Andromeda Initiative. Making sure here, because as soon as you go into this, this changes, or deselects the Nexus. Cultural exchange. With first contact established between the Initiative and the Angara, the cultural exchange has become the Initiative's de facto embassy. Behind the scenes, diplomatic staff are preparing briefs for the Nexus leadership on Angaran culture and social cues. Orientation and language classes have begun for Angara who wish to have a more long-term role on the Nexus or serve in the militia. Why would they want to serve in our initiative? In the militia, just saying. Andromeda species. Angara. This was a codex. Law and politics. This whole thing might be new. Angara practiced a political philosophy of horizontal collectivism. All members of society are valued equally, and every citizen has a voice. But the ultimate goal is for individuals to promote the best interests of the entire civilization. Angara are expected to set aside personal preferences for the greater whole, and their laws reflect this. Crimes are evaluated and punished according to the pervasiveness of their impact. An unlawful act committed against a single person carries less weight than one affecting everyone in a family. Well, that makes sense. Those who transgress in a way that undermines all Angaran society incur the maximum penalty. Leaders of large political collectives, like IS Governor, are chosen through democratic elections, preceded by contentious public debates. All candidates openly challenge each other and in turn must answer any citizen who believes them unfit for office. Elected officials serve a single term, regardless of office. Angaran culture, military doctrine. The Kett conquest of the Angara several decades ago have left their military forces virtually extinct. The few warships and ground forces to survive the initial attacks were lost through attrition to planetary defense in place of an organized military. Defense. In place of an organized military, the Angara must now rely on the resistance. Angaran leaders composed articles of war and submitted them as laws to be followed by these volunteer soldiers. The rules of engagement reflect a mindset prioritizing preservation of Angaran life and culture over vengeance on the Kett. A resistance soldier confronted by a Kett base filled with Angaran slaves, cultural artifacts, and Kett guards is expected to rescue slaves and reclaim artifacts first. Any Kett would then be destroyed with expediency and minimal cruelty, not to spare the Kett, but to uphold the integrity of Angaran civilization. Axul. Axul is a former student of the Moshai, who was captured by the Kett while studying remnant technology on Vold. He spent a year in a forced labor camp before escaping with a handful of other prisoners. Scarred physically and mentally by his experience, Exul turned his back on his studies and his life on Aya to form the Rokar, a xenophobic fighting force who used guerrilla tactics against both the Cat and Milky Way species. Jal describes Exul as annoyingly magnetic and a born leader. Among all the Mos Sei students, Exul learned the quickest. He was always surrounded by friends and admirers. Before his imprisonment, the Mos Sei believed Exul would be the one to carry on her legacy. His change in personality hit her the hardest. Angara's spirituality. Spirituality plays an important role in Angaran life, and Angaran children are raised from their first moments to follow their family's spiritual traditions. Within most Angaran faith systems, there are deities to fear or worship, and focus is placed on personal growth and the betterment of the soul. All Angara are taught the importance of meditation and quiet contemplation. One common teaching is that the soul can be heard when the mind is still. Angara also believe that the growth of a soul continues after death through rebirth. From cultural exchanges and Angaran spiritual text, most, if not all, Angara appear to believe in reincarnation. When a person dies, they are reborn within the same family. A good act performed in one life contributes to greater enlightenment in the next. The importance placed on different types of good acts seems to vary from planet to planet and even from family to family. For instance, some Angara may value acts of heroism, others acts of compassion. The variety appears limitless. So they not only believe in reincarnation, but karma as well. Which is interesting. Angara. Oh, I saw it. Lost Colony Worlds, I think. The Scourge disaster sent Angaran civilization into a dark age. Records of their golden era of technological advancement and proliferation through space only survived as oral history, making it difficult to separate truth from legend. Nevertheless, Angara believe they had colonized numerous planets across the cluster before the Scourge's devastation left them cut off from each other for centuries. As isolated Angaran worlds gradually rebuilt their technology and redeveloped space programs, the first mission was re-establishing contact with other lost colonies. A few such planets formed the coalition that now fights the Cat. The question remains if more Angaran worlds are still hidden by the Scourge, awaiting rediscovery. If they do exist, it's impossible to know what stage of development these worlds are at, what help they might offer against the Cat, and whether they will accept the Initiative's presence in the Helios Cluster. Angaran culture, economics. Angara rely on a participatory mixed economy, applying elements of socialism, capitalism, and an informal barter system. The exact means of market control varies on a contextual basis, reflecting the needs of a civilization primarily focused on its survival. Basic goods and services deemed essential to life are provided as fundamental rights, with citizens voting annually to determine exact resource allocations. Advanced personal technology or luxury items are procured through a state-controlled capitalist market. Producers and vendors are licensed by the government and monitored by arbiters to ensure they don't negatively impact essential services. Within families and tightly knit organizations like the Resistance, individual members freely trade goods and services without using currency. Value placed upon something can vary wildly, according to a person's needs. Disputes over barter trades are rare, as Angara take a long-term and generous view of economic interactions with each other. Mos Sei Sfefa, however the hell you say it. Part scientific genius, part cultural icon, Mos Sei is treated with an almost religious reverence by everyday Angara. Her technological innovations have touched nearly every facet of their civilization and were instrumental in the construction of Aya's capital city. Her analysis of the Cat threat has slowed the enemy's conquest of the Helios Cluster by informing the tactics and goals of the Resistance for decades. From Jal's recollections, the Mos Sei chafes at her celebrity status and prefers to work in solitude. Unlike most Angara, Moshe doesn't belong to a large extended family. She claims she has never married nor born children, focusing on her life's work of unraveling the mystery of remnant technology. Her goal, stated in many of her writings, is to unlock the secrets of the remnant for the benefit of all Angara, helping them to overcome the Ket and restore Angaran civilization to its pre-Scourge greatness. Ket. The Archon. I don't know what's new and what's not. I'll just read it all. The individual known as the Archon is leader of the Ket forces in the Helios Cluster. Though rarely cited, his arrival at Ket installations is reportedly greeted with fearful shows of deference. The execution of dissident Ket, and the presentation of valuable remnant technology. The Archon has maintained control of the cluster for almost 75 years, reportedly through a combination of long, patient strategies and brutal subjugation. According to Angaran sources, the Archon arrived in Helios with a pantomime of diplomatic overtures that confused the Angaran leadership and provoked them against one another before he ordered the conquest of their worlds. In recent years, the Archon has taken an increasing interest in remnant technology, ordering new dig sites and touring Ket-defending remnant structure. He is said to take many remnant specimens aboard his flagship for study at leisure. Those who interfere are executed on the spot or hunted down by the Archon's sword, his mysterious and feared enforcer. The sword, huh? According to the Moshai, the Archon is focused on Meridian, the control center for the Remnant Fault Network. In his hands, Meridian could be used to devastate the planets of the Helios Cluster, rendering them uninhabitable and giving him a hold over all sentient life here. Though he reportedly knows its location, the Archon has been unable to develop an interfacing method, meaning the greater secrets of Remnant technology are closed to him. Cat, I'm not reading all this. I'll read it, because this is new. Led by the Archon, the Ket are a powerful and technologically advanced species whose home space lies beyond the Helios Cluster. The Ket encountered here are an expeditionary force seeking life forms for exaltation, as well as secrets of the remnant technology left behind in Helios. Evidence suggests they arrived in Helios roughly 70 years ago. As we have learned, Ket multiply and replenish their armies via exaltation, where the Ket take desirable genetic traits from other life forms and incorporate them into the Ket genome. The donor life form in return is mutated with Ket DNA. Ket view this exchange as an almost sacred process of self-development, though our scientists disagree. The Ket themselves remain enigmatic. We know they value genetic and physical superiority, that they willingly enslave other species, and that they have positions throughout the Helios Cluster. Unfortunately, a sustained dialogue or diplomatic overtures seem impossible, as the Ket ruthlessly exploit any attempt at peaceful communication. Ket technology. Studies of Ket technology reveal an interesting dichotomy. While their faster-than-light drives and equipment show less sophistication than Systems Alliance technology back in the Milky Way, the Ket are vastly superior when it comes to genetic manipulation and biological analysis. Their weaponry eschews VI in support. In favor of targeting neurological systems or internal organs with unusual precision, and salvaged Ket gear shows that even their battlefield medicine is exceptional compared to the Initiative's. Nexus scientists believe that this underlines the Ket interest in biological excellence. Their technology appears to serve a subordinate role to studying and improving one's own genetic superiority. My analysis of Ket technology from your scan suggests that it is highly mimetic. It follows the Ket pattern of behavior. Rather than conducting research and development, Ket engineers incorporate features from other species and improve their designs incrementally. Remnant, and even initiative-inspired changes are already beginning to appear. Initiative-inspired changes, great. We looked at these. There's new stuff for all of these. First paragraph, I'm pretty sure we read. Communication intercepts suggest that Anointed assist in coordinating chosen squads and act in an NCO role. It is unclear if the term Anointed refers to a senior rank amongst the chosen, or if Anointed are part of a separate division within the Ket infantry. With a new understanding of Ket exaltation, it is now apparent that Anointed are exalted Angara, transformed into soldiers of the Ket cause. Their title may refer to foot soldiers who have been entrusted with a more crucial battlefield role by their superiors. Chosen. It is now apparent that Chosen or Exalted Angara transformed into soldiers of the Ket cause. This may explain their title. Their devotion to senior Ket can now be understood as a hard-wired hormonal response that induces unshakable loyalty. Wraith. Wraiths present an interesting study to Nexus scientists. Initially believed to originate from the same homeworld as the Ket, since they have similar physical characteristics, wraiths show clear genetic similarity with other feral creatures sighted across the Helios cluster. With a new understanding of Ket exaltation, this similarity can now be explained. It appears that wraiths are the result of exalting these feral creatures into faithful war beasts. I'm not sure which I didn't read here, so you guys can pause. And pause. We've got a Ket Exaltation. It's going to be an entirely new one, yeah. The facility on Vold has revealed a key element of Ket strategy in biology. The Ket do not recruit soldiers. They take prisoners and submit them to Exaltation. This process transfers beneficial genetic traits to the Ket and turns the donor into a fanatically loyal exalted, many of whom serve in the Ket military. Most of the individuals we have fought appear to be exalted Angara. Which is sad. The exaltation process appears to be two-way, transferring carefully selected Ket traits into the donor. The resulting mutations permanently alter the physical appearance and glands of the donor, including hormonal changes that cement the individual's loyalty to the Ket. I wonder if you can reverse the process some way. Scientists on the Nexus suggest that exaltation may have originated out of necessity. If long ago the Ket somehow reached a state of genetic stagnation, adopting the genetic traits of others may have been their only means of survival. Today it is a ceremonial, if morally repellent, cornerstone of Ket culture. Oh yeah. And these others, these other three, didn't that go to planets and locations? Yes, I did. Meridians. Oh yeah, I didn't. For some reason, I didn't see this. Okay, the Andromeda galaxy in general. Located, like, I didn't read that. It's weird. Located 2.5 million light years from the Milky Way, the Andromeda galaxy is the largest galaxy in the local group. also categorized as M31. Andromeda is a spiral galaxy roughly 220,000 light-years in diameter, containing approximately 1 trillion stars compared to the Milky Way's 300 billion. The Helios cluster is a large star cluster located on the galaxy's outer fringe. Andromeda has roughly 14 satellite galaxies which orbit the galactic disk. Evidence shows a disturbance where one of these companion galaxies, M32, passed through Andromeda's spiral arm several million years ago. Andromeda itself is also accelerating towards the Milky Way at roughly 100 kilometers per second. In roughly 4 billion years, the Andromeda and Milky Way galaxies will collide and merge, forming a new galactic disk. Yeah, actually, that's actually true. That's like a NASA finding or something. I don't remember reading these, so bear with me. Habitat 7. The planet known as Habitat 7 was one of the Golden Worlds selected by the Andromeda Initiative for early settlement. Signs pointed to a lush and biologically diverse tropical region that could easily support an outpost. With no communications from the Nexus or sister arcs upon arrival in the Helios cluster, the Hyperion approached Habitat 7 to begin survey and settlement operations as soon as possible. But even visual assessments showed that the planet was no longer viable. Habitat 7 is now a storm-racked world with an unbreathable argon-nitrogen atmosphere. Intense magnetic activity in unknown metallic elements interacts with the storms, causing interesting but highly destructive electrical phenomena. The investigating Pathfinder team encountered hostile alien life and strange technology on the surface. Reactivating this technology caused a noticeable change in the conditions on Habitat 7. However, the planet is still unsuitable for settlement, and the resulting activation ultimately claimed the life of Alec Ryder, the human Pathfinder. The Scourge. The Scourge is the colloquial term for a huge and extremely dangerous interstellar phenomenon sighted across much of the Helios cluster. It appears to be a cloud spreading in tendrils that affect planets and surrounding space, destroying starships that attempt to pass through or near it. Observations and data from the Nexus now show these Scourge's tendrils are composed of radioactive, element zero-rich dust and debris. Within these tendrils, thousands of microscopic and unstable warps in space-time are constantly erupting. These unpredictable distortions build up a charge in the ESO. There's a lot here. Causing uncontrolled mass effects that alter gravity and can rip a starship apart without warning. The Scourge's presence also affects nearby planets, raining down radioactive fallout and debris, or even altering the orbit of worlds that pass through or near it. The Scourge is aggressively drawn to remnant structures on planets, though the cause of the attraction is not yet fully understood. This manifests as further tendrils of dust and radioactive particulates that cling to the surface of remnant technology and interfere with its operations. Either this matter was left behind after the planet in question passed through the Scourge itself, or even distant interactions with remnant technology can cause the Scourge to coalesce spontaneously. In either case, even this minor manifestation of the Scourge demands additional caution when approaching remnant sites. No long-range data showed any sign of the Scourge before departure to the Helios cluster. Nexus scientists suggest it must have appeared in the intervening centuries while the Arcs traveled to Andromeda. One of the Scourge's more interesting characteristics is that it appears artificial. Its origin point is yet to be determined, but the pattern of the tendrils and the composition of the cloud could not have been caused by any celestial event known to astrophysics. Investigations are ongoing, though slowed by the deadly conditions created by the Scourge. And drink. Yeah, I don't think we went in this at all. So I must have moved and, like, blanked these out. So Aya didn't read. Aya is an anomaly in the Helios cluster. a lush planet where a remnant site appears to be active. It is a sanctuary for the Angara, the only known sentient species local to Helios and guarded fiercely against outsiders. This is helped by Aya's position relative to Helios' black hole, whose gravitational lensing effect makes Aya harder to detect. The Scourge also makes the approach to Aya extremely dangerous for untrained pilots. Scans indicate numerous cat wrecks lost in the Scourge nearby, picked clean by Angaran salvagers. Good for them. Aya is also the headquarters of the Angaran resistance movement against the cat, whose leaders advise Aya's planetary governor, Paran Shai. Director Tan has ordered that Aya is not only to be considered sovereign territory, but a military power. While the Tempest and its crew were allowed to visit peacefully, the Nexus is advising extreme caution to other potential visitors and ordering the distribution of early contact guidelines. Alright, so Meridian. Sorry about that. Evidence in the Aya Vault shows the network of remnant vaults across the Helios cluster is controlled from a central point known as Meridian. When properly connected to Meridian, the vaults function as designed, terraforming and maintaining planetary conditions to make planets suitable for life. When disconnected, the vaults appear to either go into standby, as seen on Eos, or malfunction, as may have happened on Habitat 7, with disastrous consequences for their planet. This proves Meridian's central importance to remnant vaults and planets of the Helios cluster. Whoever controls it can theoretically affect vault function, meaning they could control or disrupt the ecology of entire worlds. According to Moshai, blank, the Archon is aware of Meridian's location but has been unable to make use of it. This offers a new urgency to solving Meridian's mysteries. Eos. Eos, designated Habitat 1, was the earliest golden world identified for outpost placement. Named for the Greek goddess of dawn by Jean Garson personally, Eos embodied the hope of the Andromeda Initiative for a new start. On arrival, the Nexus discovered that a world projected to be arid, but comfortably habitable, was now ravaged by radioactive fallout from the Scourge. The planet's atmosphere is racked by storms that have spread the radiation across continents. Periodic 130 kilometers per hour winds strip equipment and damage shuttles. Reports from the Nexus include a sanitized account of two attempts to colonize the planet, both of which ended in failure and an unacceptable loss of life. There was also a significant cat presence on Eos, apparently investigating mysterious signals on the surface. Eos is now off-limits to unauthorized Nexus personnel, as the Nexus leadership believes it is no longer viable. I guess this is before we did that. Fixed it. Activating the vault discovered below Eos's surface has had a dramatic and immediate effect. Radioactive particles are being stripped from the atmosphere by unknown means, and the resulting temperature changes are calming Eos's high winds. The planet's moisture levels are already showing improvement. Prodromos, the first Pathfinder established outpost, has been founded in Fairwinds Basin, with Mayor August Bradley in charge. The Nexus is broadcasting footage of departing colonists and the new conditions on Eos across all communication channels. Good, two more and then we're done. I'm going to skip the Vold first because I'm really interested in the black hole. Save the best for last. Vold. From the Milky Way, the Initiative identified Vold as Habitat 6, a golden world projected to be a life-sustaining and temperate garden world. This is confirmed by Angaran historians. Vold was once a heavily populated and thriving Angaran colony. During the Scourge event, gravitational distortions affected Vold's orbit. Models from the Nexus Tech Labs show this triggered a minor ice age. The Angara were forced to withdraw to a few urban centers, with the rest of Vold's population scattered in smaller settlements. Vold is therefore both culturally and strategically important to the Angara, and has drawn the attention of the Cat. Reports suggest a significant military presence on both sides as the Angaran resistance fight to defend Vold's population and protect the ice-encased remains of their world. Initiative's new outpost, Terra of Uni, has been safely established. Led by new Mayor Priya Blake, Terra of Uni is committed to open borders with the Angara as Vold becomes more habitable. The outpost is now a major supplier of water ice to other colonies and the Nexus. Analyzing Suvi's orbital readings, it appears that the Vold Vault, unable to gravitationally compensate for Vold's change in orbit, has triggered a controlled melt of frozen carbon dioxide in the permafrost. Projections show this will thicken the atmosphere, gradually raising Vold's temperature to ease the ice age. This reveals that remnant vaults are capable of sophisticated analysis and response to planetary conditions. Black Hole, H-012 Katos. Cool. I love black holes. Awesome. At the center of the Helios cluster is a black hole, a huge star that has collapsed into a region of space-time with gravitational effects so powerful that even light cannot escape. This example is believed to be a car black hole, approximately 12 stellar masses in size, and appears to have absorbed additional mass from nearby systems. Our scientists believe that the radiation released from the creation of the black hole may explain the abundant element zero found in Helios. That's cool. In the Milky Way, study of black holes was still in its infancy. The forces around the event horizon typically destroy probes before they can transmit their data. This black hole presents a unique opportunity for study, even at a remove from a distance. The original Asari surveys of Andromeda called the black hole Ardat Hikas, Demon's Maw. Initiative charts refer to it as H-0112 Katos, after the mythological sea monster that intended to devour the princess Andromeda. That's cool. According to their scientific journals, Angaran astronomers called the black hole Harange, roughly the Fisher's Lure, for the observable effect it has on comets and surrounding systems. The gravitational lensing effect of the black hole has allowed the Angara-controlled planet Aya to go largely unnoticed by the cat. Continued observation has shown interesting interactions between the black hole and the Scourge. There is evidence that some of the Scourge's mass is being drawn into the black hole, causing continued currents in the phenomenon. Our scientists have suggested that without the black hole, the Scourge phenomenon might have been even more hazardous. No doubt. No doubt. Okay, so at some point we'll read technology in ships and vehicles, but not today. Thanks so much for watching, guys. So stay tuned next time when we embark on this. Hunting the Archon. The Moshai says the Archon has a remnant map. They may point the way to Meridian, but you don't know where his ship is. You must first track down the Angaran trader, Ventarev, on Kadara Port, and learn what you can from him. So go to Kadara Port in the Govorkum system. Oh, really? We're done? Govorkum is a different system. I thought it was on this planet. Oh, crap. Well, I don't know then. I might just go to Havarl next. Yeah. We have a few things to do on the Helios. I think just helping Liam with his project. But other than that... We could do this. We could do these two, actually. Maariko, Aya's chief astronomer, requests help locating several missing satellites essential to monitoring the Scourge. Fly the Tempest to Mariko's satellite nav points and search the areas. Investigate the first missing satellite nav point. Also, recovering the past. Avella Kayar, curator for the Repository of History on Aya, has asked you to investigate an ancient crash shuttle on Havarl and recover any artifacts. Oh, that's when we go to Havarl. So you'll do this next. Safe journeys. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. and endure. And enduring, grow strong.